Hi, so welcome to everybody. This is the first lecture of this course about transfer operators and statistical properties of dynamical systems. And maybe I will just start, though I imagine that you know about the basic of dynamical system, but let me just start to say a few things about what is the problem that I would like to discuss. So, what is the issue that I would like to motivate what I would like to talk about? So, of course, I assume that you all know what the measurable dynamical system is. So, a measurable dynamical system, there is just some space, and there is some sigma algebra, and then there is a map. And then there is an invariant measure. Well, it could also be non-invariant, but let's stick to the case in which the measure is invariant. And now one would like to study property of such a system. And one basic fact is Birkhoff's theorem that says that indeed, if you look at 1 over n, the sum 4k going from 0 to n minus 1 of G compose fk, where G, let's say, is an L1, oops, is an L1 function. This one, in fact, will converge to something mu almost surely, and this is Birkhoff theorem, and this will happen when n goes to infinity. Okay, so that's good. It tells me that, I mean, the way in which I see this is that the function g is a measurement that I do on the system. For example, it could be the characteristic function of some set, and then I just see if at a certain time the system belongs to that set or not. And the point of the theorem, it tells me that the limit exists and is invariant with respect to the dynamics. G plus is an invariant function. Okay, so there is, of course, something special, which is the case in which the system is ergodic. So we assume, I will mostly assume ergodicity. So we assume that the system is ergodic. Oops. So what does it mean, ergodics? Well, I assume that I think that you know, but just to remind you, there are many different definitions of ergodicity. In this particular case, I will just, in particular, one equivalent definition is that invariant functions are almost surely constant. Okay, so that means that the limit of that happens in Birkhoff's theorem is the system is ergodic, is an invariant function. This is part of Birkhoff's theorem, and therefore, if the system is ergodic, this must be a function which is constant. But then, if it is constant, you can take the integral of G plus, and this is going to be, of course, equal to the value of G plus if G plus is constant, is almost surely constant, and then the integral is with respect to the invariant measure mu. And this is equal to the limit for n going to infinity, since you have convergence in L1 of sum from k from G 2n minus 1, the integral over x of g compose fk in the mu. But since the function is the measure is invariant, so the integral of g compose fk is equal to the integral of g. And how many integral of g do you have? Well, you have n of them from 0 up to n minus 1. So you have n times the same thing. This is always give the same thing, the integral of g due to the invariance of mu. So this is equal to the integral over x of g in the mu. You have n of them, you divide by n. So you always obtain the same thing, which is the integral of x g mu. So that means that the limit in Birkhoff's theorem is the system is ergodic, is just the integral with respect to the invariant measure. And this is something that colloquially normally is said to, is mentioned as the fact that the time average, and this would be a time average, is equal to the space average, and this would be the space average. So they equal. And this is very interesting because it is very hard to compute this thing. Because as you see, in order to compute this thing, you have to follow the dynamics for a very long time, n goes to infinity. But it is much simpler if you know the measure mu to compute this stuff because it's just an integral. So in some sense, it tells you that if you do a measurement of a dynamical system, which is ergodic, and you measure for a time that is extremely long, then what you will see is the average of that observable of that function with respect to the invariant measure. So this is very nice. Okay, you are this that is called Birkhoff's theorem in dynamical system, but there are very similar theorem in probability, which are called law of large number. It's more or less the same. I mean, if it is exactly the law of large number in probability, if the random variable are independent among them. Okay, but there is a big problem with this fact, at least in my view, which is that if you want to apply this stuff, you do a measurement, and the measurement doesn't last an infinite amount of time. It lasts a finite amount of time. And so the question is, what happened to this sum here when n is maybe large but finite? You know that this is the limit, but still the limit can be achieved very, very slowly. And if it is achieved super slowly, then maybe in the time that you look, you will see something completely different that has nothing to do with the limit itself. And since in practice you do things for a finite time, then you are more interested in what happens for a certain fixed finite time rather for asymptotic time that maybe you will never see. So that is a little bit the motivation of this type of investigation. I mean, it's just one motivation. There are many more motivations that one can consider, and so many more reasons to look at the type of problem that I will discuss in this course. But this is kind of the simplest way to present the fact that there exists a problem and one would like to solve it. Okay, what can one expect? Unfortunately, while Birkhoff's theorem is extremely general and applies essentially to any measurable dynamical system, there is no general theorem about the speed at which the convergence takes place. I mean, essentially, this depends on the specific system that you are looking at. And maybe it's a good idea to start looking at some example, some concrete example. So let's look at two very, very simple examples so you get a feeling for what can happen. Okay. Very simple example. Let me just write a little bit bigger. So let's consider this dynamical system. I mean, I take the one-dimensional torus, the circle, I take with the usual sigma algebra, I don't write it, it's just the usual sigma algebra, and then I take Lebesgue as invariant as measured, and the map F is F of x equal x plus omega mod 1. Okay, so it's just a translation of a circle by an angle omega, and I will assume that omega is not a rational number. Okay, because if it is a rational number, then we know that all the orbits are periodic. So if you have a periodic orbit, then you can easily compute what happened in Birkhoff's theorem, and you will see. I mean, this is an exercise that you can do by yourself and find out what happens. What happens if omega is rational? Then you just can compute everything and get an idea of what's going on. But if it is irrational, then you have to, because I mean, if it is irrational, then the orbit is infinitely long. I mean, it keep visiting new places. And this is a system that is ergodic, in fact. The invariant measure is Lebesgue. And so you have a Birkhoff theorem. And the Birkhoff theorem tells you that the limit, if you have, let's make it easy. Let's imagine that G is a C1. Well, let's make it even easier. Let's take a C infinity function. So G is infinitely differentiable. We will see many times that the amount of differentiability makes a difference in dynamic systems. This is a drastic difference between random system and deterministic system. In random system, many times, what is the regularity of the observable is not so important. Maybe if you have an L2 observable, it will just do fine. But in dynamical systems, this is not the case. The regularity of the observable makes a lot of difference. And this is essentially, it's kind of intuitive why it's so. It's due to the fact that the system is deterministic. So in principle, if you know exactly the initial conditions, then you know the trajectory for all time. And if you have some uncertainty in where the trajectory will be in a very long time, this can be due only to the fact that you have some uncertainty about the initial condition. And this means that your measurement is not very precise. So you are looking at the function that is not picked on a point or something very close to being picked on a point. So a function should be a little bit spread out. And if it is a little bit spread out, measuring the function, you don't know exactly where the point is at the beginning. There is some uncertainty, and this will persist. So then it will look a little bit, I mean, there is some uncertainty in the final result. Otherwise, you do not expect to have any particular limiting situation. So, but we will see this more clearly in the following. So this is just a warning that the regularity of the function will matter in the future. So, but here, just to make it simple, it takes C infinity, so I don't have to worry about subtlety. And now, Birkhoff's theorem tells me that 1 over n, sum for k that goes from 0 to n minus 1 of g compose f k, this converges to the integral over t1 of gx dx, Lebesgue, almost surely. Okay, very good. Fine, this is just for n that goes to infinity. This is just what is true in general. I mean, it's just an application of Birkhoff's theorem to this particular system. I haven't proven to you that the system is ergodic. It's not terribly difficult to prove, but it's an exercise. If you want, you can try to prove it. Or if you fail, you can look in any textbook and you will find the proof. The textbook for dynamical system that if you want to contain most of that you may need to know is, not maybe stuff that I will discuss in this course, but all the basic, much more than the basic are there, is Kato-Kauser-Blatt. So this is a book that I recommend. and is called introduction. To dynamical system. It's a bit a joke because it's kind of a thick book, so calling it an introduction maybe because a bit of a joke, but in fact it is true that it contains the basics. So anything that you don't know about the basic, you can find in there, in particular Birkhoff theory. All right, very well, and the ergodicity of this torus translation, circle translation. Very well. Now, I would like to see what is the speed of this thing. So there are many ways of doing it, but given the simplicity of the system we are looking at, one can just use a very basic tool, this Fourier transform. So one can write G of X as the sum from from J that in Z of G at J e to the 2 pi e J x. So this is just the Fourier series of the function G. And given the fact that I have decided that the G is just infinitely differentiable, I know that the sum over J of this G at J, this stuff here in absolute value, this is converging. So this is an absolutely converging series. And this is nice, it is absolutely convergent because it means that I can switch a little bit of limits. So I can, first of all, compute what is G composed fk. So this is the sum j in z, g at j, e to the 2 pi I j. And instead of x, I have to put fk of x. But fk of x, what it is? It is simply x plus k time omega. And the mod one here, I don't need to put it because it's being multiplied by 2 pi and 2 pi I time an integer is just 1. So this is the periodicity of this function here is exactly 1. So this is periodic 1. It fits together very nicely. So this is what is G composed fk. So I can take this expression here and this expression here and put it in here and see what happened. Okay, let's see. I get 1 over n, so sum from k from 0 to n minus 1, and then I have to put g hat j, and then I have to put this stuff here because it is g composed fk here, and this is equal to this stuff. So you have to write this stuff. Oops, sorry, I forgot to write the sum of j of g hat e to the 2 pi I j x, and then I have e to the 2 pi I jk omega. Okay, so this I just wrote here, this stuff here. I put it instead of that. That's what I did. Okay, now since I said that this series here converge absolutely, I can exchange the order of the sum. Thank you. Okay, that's nice. And now I can this sum. Well, there are two possibilities. Either J is zero or J is different from zero. It doesn't matter because if J is zero, then this is always zero. And then this is just N. So let me just separate the two possibilities. If J is zero, then I get G hat zero, is the zero Fourier coefficient. Then e to the 2 pi I J, J is zero, so this is one. All this sum here is all made of one because the exponent is always zero. I have n element, but it's divided by n, so I just get this. And then I get plus 1 over n sum from j in z minus 0 now, because that I have taken away, gj e to the 2 pi ijx. And then I have to do this sum. This is kind of like a geometric sum. I know how to do that. It is 1 minus e to the 2 pi j. Omega, and this is e to the minus 2, oops, e to the 2 pi I n j omega. Okay, now I look at this stuff and I worry a little bit because I have a denominator, but the denominator is okay in principle. Because it's never zero. Because if the denominator is zero, then it means then 2 pi j omega is a multiple of an integer multiple of 2 pi I. But this means that j omega is a natural number, but this means that omega is rational, but my assumption is that omega is not rational. Okay, fine. And now I want to continue, but now to continue, I have a problem because it is true that this denominator here, this denominator is never zero, but it can be pretty small because it's true that j omega is not an integer number, but can get rather close to an integer number. And so if this is very small, this will be very large. And then, of course, you have the problem that. I start to worry that maybe I did something wrong because, well, not wrong, but I mean, of course, if this is extremely, it's true that if this is extremely small, also this will be rather small because it means that this is just k time the same quantity, right? So, but I mean, if I use the Taylor series and I say, okay, this is more or less of order of that. 1 minus this, like I can say, well, 1 minus e to the x is more or less of order x if x is small. And if here I have kx, this will be of order kx, but in the denominator I have e to the minus x. So this will be more or less x, and that would be order k. But this is huge, it's kind of large, you know, because that would mean that this sum grows like N essentially, because this is N. Oops, sorry, this is N. So this will be NKNX. You have NX, this is NX, and then will be more or less N. So you see, if this is of order N, then I mean, it means that all this sum, since this is the hat J. GJ are summable, all this sum will be of order n, all this sum would be of order n, this is 1 over n, so this would be of order 1. So it means that the different, this is the limit actually, right? Because the zero Fourier coefficient is nothing else. And we know that this is the limit, but this limit here is also g at zero. The zero Fourier coefficient is nothing else than the averages of the function. So you have that. This is the limit. This is the correction to the limit, and you get the correction to the limit maybe of order one if you do not look at this, if you do this very, very stupid estimate. And then it means that you cannot, you are not even proving that there is the limit, even though you know that there is the limit. So you need to do better. But to do better, unfortunately, you need to know something about omega, right? If this depends from omega, what how the size of this quantity is. Size of this quantity here depends on not just the fact that omega is irrational, but how irrational is omega. And this is what I ask. For example, let's ask a very strong property. Okay, this means that this is a quadratic Diophantine. I don't know how to write it. Maybe there is a Y. I don't know. Number. I don't know how people write it, this in English. Whatever. So it means, but this is the property, right? So it means that this you cannot. For example, just to give you an example, square root of 2 is such a number. Or also 1 over square root of 2 is such a number. So this is just any quadratic irrational has this property. You can have more general thing, like instead of having q squared, you can have q to any power, or even exponential if you want. But let's just stick with this very simple. This is the simplest possible situation that one can have. Imagine that the translation satisfies a Diophantine number that satisfies this. Then you can estimate this quantity because you have that. Two pi I j, which is omega. Okay. This, you can look at it, what is the difference between this and, well, actually 2 pi, you don't really need also the I. Okay, look at what is the difference between this and how small is this and an integer number. Because if here you have an integer number, if here you have an integer number, then this would be 1 and that would be 0. So you want to see how close you are. So you want to see how close you are to this being p integer. But then you can write it as p, sorry, you can write it as j, which we know that j is different from 0 because we took away j equal from 0 here. Okay. So you have j and then you have omega, you have omega minus p over j. And now you use the fact that this is a Diophantine number and then you get j, some constant gamma over j squared. So this is gamma over j. And then you can check that 1 minus e to the 2 pi I j omega, this will be bigger or equal than some constant c, which depends on gamma, divided by j. And then if you use this fact, you can use this fact here, and then you get that all this quantity, which is the difference from the limit, it is 1 over n, sum from k, from zero, no, sorry, from j in z minus zero of, so I just take the absolute value and I bring the absolute value inside. So if I bring the, I take the absolute value of this quantity, okay, then I bring the absolute value inside. This is the absolute value of this. The absolute value of this is 1. The absolute value of this is 1, so this is smaller than 2. So there is some 2 here. Okay. And then I use the estimate on the absolute value of the stuff, and that is J over C. Okay, so all that is going to be equal, is going to be smaller than sum J in Z minus zero, G hat, and then is J, absolute value, actually. Okay, but since C, G is C infinity, the Fourier the J's Fourier coefficient, oops, sorry. The J's Fourier coefficient multiplied by J, it is, this is still is bounded. So this, all this is a constant, and then there is some constant here, see. So this is just a constant, it doesn't matter what it is, divided by n. So that is the conclusion, that in this very special case, the difference between the limit and the difference between the limit and the average at the finite time is of the order of one over the time. And notice that you cannot really do better than that, because you see each time that you increase n, you just add another term. So you add something of order one, and it is defined by one over n. So the difference between a sum of order n and the sum of order, I mean, up to time n, and the sum of order n plus one, it's just something of order over n, so one over n. So you cannot expect the convergence to be better than one over n. So in this particular case, the convergence is as fast as possible. And it is exactly exactly one over n. In particular, if you do not put n, and if the function is zero average, then it follows that, so it means that this guy is zero, and it means that the limit is zero. Then this stuff is of order one over n. This stuff is, so that means that this stuff here is of order one. So you do a sum of arbitrary number of terms, but the sum doesn't grow. It keeps being bounded. And this in particular implies that, in this particular case, implies that you can write that one can prove essentially with the same argument, similar argument, using Fourier transform, for example, one can prove that G is a coboundary. What does it mean? It means it exists a phi. In this case, also in C infinity, if everything is in, if G is in C infinity, such that G is equal to phi compose F minus phi. And it's clear that if you have such a situation, then you understand how come that the sum is bounded. Because if you do this, this is equal to the sum 0 n minus 1 phi compose F. Oops, sorry, k. K plus one minus phi compose f k. This is a telescopic sum. Everything cancels but the first and the last term. So the last term is phi compose f n, and the first term is phi. And so you see, it's just this is just smaller than twice the norm of phi. So it doesn't grow. And if you think about it, this is very similar, this is very reminiscent if of von Neumann proof of the mean ergodic theorem. I mean, this von Neumann has this proof of the ergodic theorem for function in L2, in which the convergence is only an L2 convergence, so it's weaker than Birkhoff theorem, but it is very instructive, this proof. If you look at the proof, you will see that the key ingredient in the proof is exactly the fact that you write function, you take function and you write them as invariant function plus coboundaries, exactly in this form. And the coboundary has this property that of course, the ergodic average of a co-boundary is zero because the sum doesn't grow. So if you divide by 1 over n, that's zero. Okay, so this is the situation for the, so it seems that you get a very strong convergence to the to what you want. What about, so it's always the same, it's always the case, you can think, well, already what I said, it's a little bit fishy, no? Because you, it's hard to expect that is always the case, because if omega does not satisfy this condition, or G is not, and another possibility, G is not very smooth, so this Fourier coefficient go to zero very slowly, then it's not really clear that you can still do an argument like that. But, okay, this would take us away, astray from what I want to talk about. So let me just consider instead, but still, for this system with very regular motion, it seems that you get a very strong convergence to the limit. Let's consider a system of a different nature. Always on the torus, the sigma algebra is always the same, and always the invariant measure is the back. But now the map is fx equal 2x mod 1. Okay, so this is just the doubling map. And now you want to try to do the similar thing. Okay. Well, if you try to do it by Fourier transform, then you get in trouble because it's complicated, right? It's not really clear what. So it's not really clear what to do, but let's just consider this quantity that you are interested in. So let's take a function g. So we know again by Birkhoff theorem that this will converge to the average of G. And let's by simplicity take the case in which the average of Z is zero. Right, this is just, you can always reduce to this by subtracting the average to the function G. If you subtract the average, then of course the average is just 1 over n sum from k from k from 0 to n minus 1. Of the average compose fn, but the average is a constant, compose fn is always the average, and then you have n of them, you divide, and you get the average. So you can always reduce yourself by subtracting to g the average to the case in which the average is zero. So let me just assume that the average is zero. And now I would like to know, so now the question is how quickly this guy goes to zero. So one possibility to do that is just to compute the second momentum of this quantity. That is, I want to compute the integral of 1 over n sum from k from 0 to n minus 1 of g compose f. Oh, sorry, this is k, it's not n. K square x dx. So I just compute the non-square of this quantity, hoping that this will give me some information on what the size of the quantity is. Okay, so this is what it is. This is 1 over n square. Then I have a double sum, the sum over k and the sum over j from 0 up to n minus 1. This is the integral on T1, the integral on T1, and then I have G compose FK, G compose FJ, DX. And now, I want to divide the situation. There is the case in which K is equal to J, so this is a special situation. If k is equal to j, since the measure is invariant, so this will be g square compose fk of x dx, but this is an invariant measure, Lebesgue. It's easy to check that Lebesgue is invariant. And then since it is invariant, it follows that the average of a function composed with the dynamics is equal to the average of the function. So this is like Then you have two possibilities. K can be bigger than J, or J can be bigger than K, but this is exactly the same, because if you switch the role of K and J, you get exactly the same. So you get twice the sum, for example, K bigger than J, the integral over Q1, G compose FK, G compose FJ. Okay, but now you can write this in a slightly different manner. And then you use again the invariance to show that this composition with Fj is completely useless. And then you get this formula over here. So this first term there is always the same. You have n term and is divided by 1 over n squared. So you get 1 over n, the integral of q2 g x squared dx. And the other term, it is twice n squared. And then you have the sum. And now let me write this a little bit different. So this is k bigger than j. But here the function is k minus j. So maybe I want to change index and I call k minus j, I call it L. So let me call L equal k minus j. And then L, where can it go? L can go from 1 to infinity, because K is strictly bigger than J, because the case K equal J, I took it out, is here. The case of K equal J is this case. So here K is strictly bigger than, sorry, it's here, I meant. So this K is strictly bigger than J. So the smaller it can be is 1, and it can go up to infinity. So this is the sum from j, it goes from 1 up to infinity. And once I have fixed k minus j, what can happen to what can happen to this sum? So the sum is so essentially, let's say that the new variable are L, K minus J, and J. So if I fix L, how many value J can take? Well, since J is smaller than K, it can get up to K, but the minimal value possible is zero. So if J can be equal to zero, it can take all the value up to L minus one, because it cannot be L, because if J would be equal to L, K would have to be zero, but this is not possible because it is just, well, no, actually it's perfectly possible, right? So. What is not possible is that it's better to take K then as a oops. Okay, so, oops, I am finishing. So this should be J, and then you have this thing. K minus J, okay. So, you have J terms that are like this. You cannot have more than J terms. And this now remain to study this quantity. That is what is missing in order to have an estimate, because this term here is of order 1 over n, but remind that we are looking at this quantity squared. So if this quantity squared is of order 1 over n, so it means that the quantity itself, you expect it to be more or less the order 1 over square root of n. If this guy here is not too big, okay? So that is the thing that we are left with. We have to compute this quantity. And now to compute this quantity, is, you see, this is called the correlation. It's just the function g integrated against the function g computed at a later time, at the time j. So problem is to compute the correlation. And this is kind of the problem that more or less one has to study, and the problem that I would like to address in this course, how to compute this quantity. And just consider, to see what can happen, just consider this case. So consider this function has value 1 and minus 1, and it is an exercise to check what can happen, but you will see that this is equal to this. This is 0. So this term here is just 0 for this particular function. So you get that indeed the leading term is this one. This can be, I mean, this is an exercise. Just look at what happened to you. So you have just to notice that f of, so this is the interval E1, this is the interval E2, f of Ej is equal to essentially all the torus, almost surely. There are some, just one point that, or two points that can be missing. So if you consider this, then you can easily understand what happened to this integral and compute it and see that it always gets out zero. So, okay. So that means that the limit, you expect that in this particular case with this function, the size of 1 over n sum from k that goes from 1 to n minus 1, g compose fk, this is more or less of order 1 over square root of n. So it's completely different from before, completely different behavior. And that reflects the fact that the two systems are completely different. One has a very regular motion. The other one has a motion that is not regular at all. It is depends strongly from the initial condition. And this is the subject of the rest of my lecture. I would like to understand more in general what happened to this, how to study these correlations here, how to study these correlations, and how one can more generally address this type of question, what happened to the, because here I haven't really told you what happened to the limit, right? I just said, I just said that it is of a certain size, okay? But this is made for a very special special function in the first place, and then in the second place, I could decide to divide by square root of n. And then the question is, what will happen to this divided by square root of n and not by n, since I expect this then to be of order one. Okay, so I'm sorry, I'm over time. I stop, and I will then continue next time explaining to you such things. Okay, so thanks a lot.